Hello class, today we will discuss about retaining wall. This is the last topic in our syllabus. Content of this topic are introduction, components of retaining wall. We will also discuss about application of the retaining wall, type of the retaining wall, forces acting on the retaining wall, gravity retaining wall, cantilever retaining wall, design criteria and stability checks. Before the jumping in our topic, first of all, we have to understand what is the retaining wall. Retaining wall is the structure to use to retain the earth or other material and maintain ground surface at different elevation on either side of it. Retaining wall are used to retain earth or other materials which have the tendency to slide and repose at the particular inclination. They provide lateral support to the backfill, embankment, or in order to hold them in vertical position. Components of the retaining wall. Main components of the retaining wall you can see in the picture. This is the stem, this is the toe, this is the key, and this is the heel. And in case of the counterfort retaining wall, we can consider counterforts. Application of retaining wall. We can use the different areas like construction of basement below the ground level in the buildings, wing wall and abutment in the bridge work are designed as a retaining wall to retain slopes in hilly terrain. A roads is the side wall of bridge approach road to provide lateral support to the embankment. Type of the retaining wall. In our syllabus, the different type of the retaining walls are as follows. First one is the gravity retaining wall, cantilever retaining wall, counterfort retaining wall, buttress wall, bridge abutment, and box culverts. We will start from the gravity retaining wall. You can see in the picture, the gravity retaining wall is maintained by its own weight. It is generally made up to a height of 3 meter wall. Second one, cantilever retaining wall. You can see in the picture, the cantilever retaining wall is made by the RCC, reinforced cement concrete, and it consists of the vertical wall, heel slab, toe. You can see in the picture, stem, toe slab, and heel slab, and act as a cantilever beam. It is generally used when the height of up to the 6 meter. The cantilever retaining wall are three types, T-shape, L-shaped, T-shaped with shear key. Third one is a counterfort retaining wall. Counterfort retaining wall, you can see in the picture, in this type of the retaining wall, the stem and base are tied together by counterfort at suitable intervals. Economical for the height over the 6 meter. Buttress wall. In the buttress wall, this type of the wall is the modification of the counterfall wall with counterfort called buttress provided but other side of the backfill. You can see in the picture. Bridge abutment. You can see in the picture the bridge abutment similar to the top of the stem of the retaining wall is braced by deck slab of bridge. And the last one is a box culvert. You can see in the picture, this is the closed rigid frame consisting of single or multiple cells. Forces acting on retaining wall. You can see in the picture, the main forces is lateral force. Like you can see in the picture, this is the active earth pressure acting on the retaining wall. And this is the passive earth pressure acting on the retaining wall. And second one is a self weight of the retaining wall, weight of the soil above the base slab, surcharge load, soil reaction below base of slab, and friction force at the top and bottom of base slab. So these are the forces acting on the retaining wall. And let's talk about Rankine's theory for particular 5 soil. It means for cohesionless soil. So there are the main 5 conditions we have to discuss for the finding the lateral earth pressure. First one is a dry or merged backfill with no surcharge. Second one is a submerged backfill. Third condition is backfill with uniform surcharge. Fourth one is backfill with sloping surcharge. And last one is the inclined back and surcharge. First condition, this is the normal condition. You can see in the picture, dry or moist backfill with no surcharge. The pressure at the base, you can see in the picture, K into gamma into H. What is K? K means coefficient of the earth pressure. We can find by 1 minus sine 5 divided by 1 plus sine 5. What is phi? Phi means internal friction angle of the soil. What is gamma? Unit weight of the soil. And what is H? Height of the wall. So pressure at the base you can find out by Ka into gamma into H. If you want to find out the total pressure, you can find out by the area of the triangular. How we can find out the area of the triangle? This side is H, this side is Ka into gamma into H. It means total area 1 half into Ka into gamma into H. Into H, it means 1 half into Ka into gamma into H square. So this is the total pressure acting on the retaining wall. So this pressure is acting 1/3 of the height of total height of the wall from the base. So this is the normal case. This is the first case, dry or moist backfill with no surcharge. Second case, submerged backfill. In case of the water mass is acting on the retaining wall, so we have to consider the pressure coming from the water mass. So there will be two types of the pressure. First one is the submerged unit weight of the soil mass, and second one is the pressure coming from the water mass. So due to submerged weight, gamma dash of the soil, you can see in the picture, Ka into gamma into H. This is the first portion. And second one is a lateral pressure due to the water mass. You can see in the picture, K gamma of water into H. This is the base of the pressure. So total pressure will be K into gamma dash into H plus gamma of water into H. So total pressure will be Ka into gamma dash into H plus gamma of water into H. So this is the second type of the condition, submerged backfill. In case of the backfill is partially submerged, in case you have to find out the pressure by empirical formula, Ka into gamma into H1 plus Ka into gamma dash into H2 plus gamma of water into H2. So by this equation, you can find out the lateral earth pressure acting on the retaining wall. Third case is backfill with uniform surcharge. You can see in the pressure diagram, uniform surcharge load is acting on the retaining wall. So there will be two types of the pressure will act on the retaining wall. First one is a pressure due to the surcharge, and second one is a pressure due to the backfill. It means there will be summation of the total pressure of pressure due to the surcharge load and pressure due to the backfill. Pressure due to the surcharge load is Ka into Q. What is Ka? Ka means coefficient of the earth pressure, and Q means uniform surcharge load. And pressure due to the backfill, you can see in the triangular portion, Ka means coefficient of the earth pressure, gamma means unit weight of the soil mass, and H means height of the wall. So there will be total load of K into Q plus K into gamma into H. So you can see in this empirical formula. And fourth one is a backfill with sloping surcharge. In hilly area, sloping surcharge load is acting on the retaining wall. So we have to consider this type of the load, this type of the pressure. So there is a change only one thing. We have to change methodology to find out the Ka. So generally we are applying for finding K is 1 minus sine 5 divided by 1 plus sin phi. But in this case, we have to find out k by this empirical formula, which is cos beta into cos beta minus cos square beta minus cos square phi divided by cos beta plus cos square beta minus cos square phi. And last case is inclined back. You can see in this pressure diagram, this is the inclined back. In this inclined back, the weight of the soil mass is acting vertically and horizontal pressure is acting in this direction. So we have to find out the resultant pressure P by W square plus P1 square whole root. You can see forces acting on gravity wall in this figure. W weight of the rate of the gravity retaining wall. This is the active earth pressure PAH and distance is Z1, and in this side passive earth pressure PPH. Design criteria of retaining wall. So in design criteria, we have to consider some important points, like the base width of wall must be such that the maximum pressure exerted on the foundation soil does not exceed the soil bearing capacity of soil. No tension should be developed anywhere in the wall. No wall must be safe against the sliding. And the last consideration, we should consider the wall must be safe against overturning. Stability checks. Before the designing, we have to check the stability checks with four consideration, like no sliding, no overturning, no tension, and no bearing failure. First one is a no sliding. We have to find out factor of safety for no sliding is resisting force divided by sliding force. Like you can see in this equation, mu into Rv divided by Rh. Sliding force means horizontal force. Resisting force means mu into Rv. And mu means coefficient of the friction between the base of the wall and the foundation soil, which is tan phi. Phi is the internal friction of soil. Stability checks. Second consideration, no overturning. In this consideration, we have to find out the factor of safety with this equation, the sum of the restoring moments at toe divided by sum of the overturning moments at toe. It means WR, resisting moments, means, and sigma MO, overturning moments. So it should be greater than 1.5. Third one is no tension for stability check. For no tension in the wall, eccentricity should not exceed B by 6. We have to find out the sigma max is equal to Rv divided by B, 1 plus 6e by B at toe. Sigma minimum, stress minimum, Rv divided by B, 1 minus 6e by B at heel. Eccentricity less than B by 6. In this case, the stress anywhere on the base of the wall is compressive. Second thing, if eccentricity equal to B by 6, the stress anywhere on the base of the wall is compressive, with its value at top at the heel equal to 0. If eccentricity greater than B by 6, tensile stress is developed at heel and compressive stress in this developed at toe. So we have to consider these criteria for the stability checks in no tension. And last one is no bearing capacity failure for stability checks. In this case, we have to find out the factor of safety allowable bearing capacity divided by maximum pressure at the bed. It means the maximum pressure at the base of the wall should not exceed the allowable bearing capacity. It means factor of safety should be greater than 1. Thank you.